An English Christmas by John Julius Norwich. Read by Gareth Armstrong, Nicky Diss, Sandra Duncan, and Luke Thompson. Introduction. Christmas, or something very like it, was thousands of years old by the time Jesus Christ was born. And no wonder. Humanity has always celebrated a midwinter festival. On or around the shortest day of the year, we all need cheering up. And fortunately, in earliest times, this was about the only time of year that we might expect a fairly plentiful supply of fresh meat, as the farmers slaughtered the livestock that they would be unable to feed in the hungry months to come. And there was another reason, too, in which many found consolation, that most of the wine and beer made during the year would now be nicely fermented and ready for drinking, so that we could make a really good feast of it. Yuletide, Saturnalia, Hogmanay, almost every religion, every civilization of the cold north has taken the idea to their hearts. But the Christians have made a far better job of it than anyone else. They weren't content with settling for Christmas as just a winter tradition. Instead, they welded it into the very fabric of their religion, making it Christ's birthday. No one, of course, has the foggiest idea when he was actually born, but who cares? Like the Queen, he has an official birthday which suits us, and that's what counts. I've celebrated a good many Christmases of my own. That of 2017 will be my 88th, and I've always been fascinated, occasionally enchanted, and sometimes faintly appalled by the wildly extravagant trappings that have grown up around this former pagan barbecue. Already in 1377, guests at the first Christmas feast given by King Richard II were consuming a total of 28 oxen and 300 sheep. It must have been quite a party. But inevitably, there have been other rulers who preferred something rather simpler. Oliver Cromwell, indeed, went perhaps a little too far in his Puritan way and banned Christmas altogether. But this was not a success, and there were protests all over the country. In some towns, it was said, there was more holly and mistletoe to be seen than before the Commonwealth began. And the formerly innocent carols, now transformed into songs of protest, were bellowed out with such raucous enthusiasm that on Christmas Day 1656, members of Parliament complained that they'd been kept awake all night by the noise. One suspects, even then, that the celebrations 4 years later, after the return of Charles II, may have been noisier still. The festival that they knew, however, would have been very different from what it is today. For Christmas, as we know it, is a largely 19th century phenomenon, the joint invention of two very different men, Albert, the Prince Consort, and Charles Dickens. It was Albert who popularised the Christmas tree, the tradition of the Yule log, a huge block of wood which was kept burning throughout the 12 days of Christmas, was already known in England and went back probably to Anglo-Saxon times. But the idea of bringing a whole tree into the house, and not to burn but to decorate and to make the centre for the exchange of presents, that was unknown in England until his day. The prince is also often wrongly credited with the invention of the Christmas card. But the first bunch of these was actually dispatched in 1843 by Sir Henry Cole, who went on to be responsible, far more than Albert, who again took most of the credit, for the Great Exhibition of 1851. And then there was Dickens. But for him, our traditional Christmas might have remained a royal idiosyncrasy. It's thanks to him, and above all to A Christmas Carol, that we know how Christmas should be celebrated. It certainly galvanised the Victorians. Upon finishing A Christmas Carol, the reclusive philosopher Thomas Carlyle was seized with a perfect convulsion of hospitality and actually insisted on improvising two dinner parties with only a day between. Cue Jane Carlyle's very amusing letter about her struggles to prepare the turkey. Like the Carlyles, we may ourselves fall somewhat short of the ideal. Or, like my Uncle John, we may go well beyond it. Let me explain why. Everyone has their own idea of Christmas, based very largely, I suspect, on those that they remember from their childhood. With increasing age, the annual celebrations become somehow less important, if only because one's gone through so many of them that they all seem to have telescoped together. To a child, on the other hand, and particularly to a child as ridiculously lucky as I was, Christmas was a wonderful thing indeed, looked forward to at least since the previous midsummer. For the first decade of my life, up to the beginning of the Second World War, it was always spent at Beaver Castle, the home of Uncle John, Duke of Rutland, my mother's older brother. Even now, the scale of his hospitality astonishes me. The entire family would be there, including those of his four siblings, together with several more elderly relations, mostly, as I remember, bachelor uncles and maiden aunts. Nearly all, in those days, would bring their valets and their ladies' maids. For lunch and dinner, there'd thus be 20 or more grown-ups in the dining room, with perhaps a couple of dozen extra in the servants' hall, over and above the countless staff of the castle itself. And then there were all the children, with their nannies and governesses, divided between the nursery and the schoolroom, perhaps another 20 altogether. All told, there cannot have been fewer than 50 or 60 extra mouths to feed, most of them for more than a week, since we nearly all stayed over the New Year. The excitement began on around the 20th of December with the arrival from the cellar of our house in London of several enormous cabin trunks to be packed. Looking back on it, I'm staggered by the sheer amount of packing that took place, every item meticulously wrapped in tissue paper. By the time it was finished, on the 23rd, it took two men to carry the by now unbelievably heavy luggage down to the waiting taxi, in which my parents, my nanny and I took a taxi to King's Cross, in those days still grey, cavernous and caked with grime, and boarded the train to Grantham. It would be pitch dark by the time we arrived at the gas-lit station, where two huge Rolls-Royces lurked, ready to receive us. Onto these, with the help of a regiment of porters, there was no shortage of them in those days, long before wheelless suitcases had been invented, the trunks would be slowly and painfully loaded. And off we went. To a 5 or 6 year old, still unused to being out at night, the 20-minute journey was wildly exciting, watching the rabbits scuttling away from the headlights and then suddenly catching one's first sight of that tremendous floodlit castle, standing high and immensely impressive on its hill, visible for miles from any direction. 10 more minutes would bring us to the immense door from which a short passage led to the entrance hall, known as the gunroom, its walls bristling with swords, spears and blunderbusses, with, in its centre, the tree. And what a tree it was! In my memory, a good 20 feet high, gloriously decorated, piled with presents and lit with real candles, 100 or more of them. Liveried footmen in dark blue tailcoats with brass buttons gleaming stood around holding long poles with wet sponges on the ends, ready to act in an emergency. And then at last to the bedroom that I always shared with Nanny, warmed by a roaring coal fire, no central heating in that wing at any rate, and on to a quick supper and bed. The following days were completely traditional. Carol singers, Christmas stockings at the foot of the bed, while shepherds watched and O come all ye faithful in the chapel, opening of presents around the tree, Christmas pudding, how many of them must have been consumed, and mince pies galore. The rest of our days were taken up with visits to the stables, with apples and lumps of sugar to hold out flat-handed to the horses. To the kennels, slightly less popular merely because the hounds couldn't be fed. To the dairy, with its wonderful milky smell, its butter churns and its huge dishes of cream, where one was given glasses of warm, foaming milk straight from the cow. To the sawmill, where for the first and very nearly the last time in my life I planed a piece of wood. And, of course, to the forge, where I was allowed to work the bellows. Best of all was the Boxing Day meet of the beaver hunt, all pink coats and excited yelping dogs and stirrup cups and ladies sitting bolt upright on side saddles with top hats and veils and flowing black skirts descending to the heels of their riding boots. Then came New Year's Eve, still very much part of the Beaver Christmas, and the huge treat, from the age of about 7 or 8, of being allowed to stay up till midnight to sing Auld Lang Syne and to see the New Year in. The children didn't actually have dinner with the grown-ups. That would have been purgatory for all involved, but went into the dining room when they'd finished, but while they were still sipping their port. There'd be an hour and a half still to go before midnight, the space being filled by party games. Charades was the favourite, though I personally preferred The Game, which involved trying to express a well-known book title or proverb in dumb show. There was another game, too, in which two people assumed historical roles and had a short conversation, during which each had to guess the identity of the other. I still remember one session which lasted only a few seconds. It began with one lady saying, "I think the smell was the worst thing of all." "Mrs. Noah," said the other lady, and she was right. It suddenly dawns on me that, as yet, I have not said a single word about Father Christmas. Who, I wonder, invented him? He's originally St. Nicholas, we all know that. We also know that his body was removed from the church of Mara, now Demre in Turkey, where I've seen his empty grave. But by whom? According to one account, the body snatchers were sailors from Bari, where a large and most magnificent church, even better than the cathedral, was erected in his honour. But the Venetians also claim responsibility, firmly maintaining that he's buried in their rather more modest church on the Lido that bears his name, to which the Doge and his Signoria took part in a solemn procession every year on his feast day. Oddly enough, both versions may be right. Recent scientific investigations suggest that the relics in the two cities may belong to the same body. But when did St. Nicholas become Father Christmas? Probably in the reign of Henry VIII, when he was represented as a fat, jolly, bearded gentleman in scarlet, or sometimes green, robes, trimmed with white fur. As now, he typified the spirit of Christmas good cheer. But there was a lot of work to be done before he assumed the ho-ho-ho shape and figure we know today. All the later accoutrements, the reindeer and the sleigh, the descent down the chimney, the filling of the stockings, all this is 19th century and even early 20th, with probably not a little American influence thrown in. In a long life, containing plenty of parenthood, I've always managed to avoid dressing up as Father Christmas. My word, how I'd have hated it. It was bad enough creeping into my children's bedrooms in the dark to hang up their stockings, always terrified that they'd wake up and see what an impostor their father really was. As a boy, I think I managed to maintain my own unquestioning belief until I was 5 or 6. Shirley Temple used to claim that she lost hers at about the same age when she met Santa Claus in a large department store and he asked her for her autograph. Few children, I fear, could say the same today. A single glance at one of those photographs of a Father Christmas reunion, 100 or so of them all milling around together, would disenchant them forever. Christmases like those we had at Beaver don't come like that anymore, and I'm not sure that I could take them if they did. The world has changed, on the whole, I believe, for the better, though I could perhaps suggest one or two minor improvements. Nowadays, Christmas is for me a quiet family affair, staying with my daughter or stepson. Not so exciting, perhaps, as in the old days. How could it be? As birthday succeeds birthday, one loses, alas, the capacity for excitement. But every bit is enjoyable. There have been the occasional exceptions. Some 20 or 30 years ago, Molly and I spent Christmas on the coast of Kenya, sharing our room with a couple of dozen hermit crabs and frequently meeting a herd of baboons when we went down to swim. The heat was intense, the pudding was late arriving, and we had our Christmas dinner on the 27th. More recently, by way of contrast, I went with my granddaughter, my son-in-law Anthony Beaver, and my son Jason to the Antarctic on a Russian icebreaker. That was unlike any Christmas I've ever known. It was, very largely, a Christmas of silence. In the world in which we normally live, silence simply doesn't exist. Even when we think we have found it, we are, like as not, subconsciously shutting our ears to the ordinary sounds of nature, the rustle of branches, the trickle of water, the song of a bird. In the Antarctic, even those sounds are exceptions. Silence stands no longer as a negative concept, but as a present, positive thing, wrapping itself around you like a cloak. Occasionally, however, it would be rudely broken by a party of Finns among our fellow passengers, who daily stripped to the buff and splashed about among the icebergs. The evenings, too, tended to get a trifle noisy, particularly after our Christmas dinner, when we were all asked to sing a song. I obliged with one about the Titanic, which, I felt, was only fairly well received. But there, you won't find much about baboons or icebergs in the pages that follow. Some of the pieces we've chosen will probably be familiar, but I like to think that a good many of them, at least, will be new to you. I've spread the net as widely as I could, fact and fiction, verse and prose, from the Middle Ages to the present day. Letters and diaries, I find, are a particularly fruitful source of treasure, diaries in particular. Among these, I'd particularly like to draw your attention to the entries by that unlikely pair, the Reverend Francis Kilvert and Sir Cecil Beaton. The two have little enough in common, apart from their nationality. But that's enough. Which reminds me, perhaps I should say a word about the title of this book, An English Christmas. Admittedly, not every item is set in England, but whether we're reading about Sir Ernest Shackleton trapped in the polar ice or about Elizabeth David struggling with her Christmas pudding for those profoundly ungrateful French villagers, we are, I think, always conscious of their essential Englishness. Reading their accounts, we instantly recognise them as our compatriots. For the truth is that Christmas as we know it is still an essentially English feast. Even in America it isn't quite the same, while on the continent of Europe it varies almost wherever you go. The French copy us up to a point, largely because their shops do so well, but their celebrations tend to be in a distinctly lower key than ours, and it's at the New Year that they exchange their presents, which even have a special name, Etrenne. For the rest of the year they're simply cadeaux. To compensate, they make a much bigger thing of Epiphany, a date which is in England so much forgotten that relatively few of the younger generation could, I suspect, even tell you what it is or when it falls. We know it, insofar as we know it at all, as Twelfth Night. For the French, however, and for many other European countries, it's the Fête des Rois, commemorating the arrival at the manger of the three kings. And it's quite a celebration, featuring a special cake of puff pastry filled with frangipani cream and containing a small charm, the finder of which becomes king of the feast and is crowned with a gold paper crown. All very well, one feels, but perhaps a little un-English. And so, in the pages that follow, we're sticking firmly to English Christmases. By no means all of them are a paean of praise to the Feast of the Nativity. George Orwell, Evelyn Waugh, Philip Larkin are only three of those who positively hated it. A good many other people do too. I have one friend who annually travels to deepest Asia in order to escape it, and several others who would probably do so if they could. On the whole, however, the verdict is favourable. The general conclusion is that it's here to stay. For my part, I love it dearly. I just wish it didn't come around about every 3 months. I leave you with a parting thought from a Christmas card sent to me some years ago by some friends in Jerusalem. Roses are red, violets are bluish. If it wasn't for Christmas, you'd all be Jewish. Happy Christmas. Part 1, Advent.
Christmas by John Betjeman. The bells of waiting Advent ring, the tortoise stove is lit again, and lamp oil light across the night has caught the streaks of winter rain in many a stained glass window sheen from Crimson Lake to Hooker's Green. The holly in the windy hedge and round the manor house the yew will soon be stripped to deck the ledge, the altar, font and arch and pew, so that the villagers can say, "The church looks nice," on Christmas Day. Provincial public houses blaze, corporation tramcars clang, on lighted tenements I gaze, where paper decorations hang, and bunting in the red town hall says, "Merry Christmas to you all." And London shops on Christmas Eve are strung with silver bells and flowers as hurrying clerks the city leave to pigeon-haunted classic towers, and marbled clouds go scudding by the many-steepled London sky. And girls in slacks remember Dad, and oafish louts remember Mum, and sleepless children's hearts are glad, and Christmas morning bells say come, even to shining ones who dwell safe in the Dorchester Hotel. And is it true, this most tremendous tale of all, seen in a stained glass window's hue, a baby in an ox's stall, the maker of the stars and sea become a child on earth for me? And is it true, for if it is, no loving fingers tying strings around those tissued fripperies, the sweet and silly Christmas things, bath salts and inexpensive scent, and hideous tie so kindly meant? No love that in a family dwells, no carolling in frosty air, nor all the steeple-shaking bells can with this single truth compare, that God was man in Palestine and lives today in bread and wine.
Dinner at the Westons, from Emma, by Jane Austen. Mr. Woodhouse had so completely made up his mind to the visit that, in spite of the increasing coldness, he seemed to have no idea of shrinking from it, and set forward at last most punctually with his eldest daughter in his own carriage, with less apparent consciousness of the weather than either of the others. Too full of the wonder of his own going, and the pleasure it was to afford at Randall's to see that it was cold, and too well wrapped up to feel it. The cold, however, was severe, and by the time the second carriage was in motion, a few flakes of snow were finding their way down, and the sky had the appearance of being so overcharged as to want only a milder air to produce a very white world in a very short time. Emma soon saw that her companion was not in the happiest humour. The preparing and the going abroad in such weather, with the sacrifice of his children after dinner, were evils, were disagreeables at least, which Mr. John Knightley did not by any means like. He anticipated nothing in the visit that could be at all worth the purchase, and the whole of their drive to the vicarage was spent by him in expressing his discontent. "A man," said he, "must have a very good opinion of himself when he asks people to leave their own fireside and encounter such a day as this for the sake of coming to see him. He must think himself a most agreeable fellow. I could not do such a thing. It is the greatest absurdity. Actually snowing at this moment. The folly of not allowing people to be comfortable at home, and the folly of people's not staying comfortably at home when they can. If we were obliged to go out such an evening as this, by any call of duty or business, what a hardship we should deem it. And here are we, probably with rather thinner clothing than usual, setting forward voluntarily without excuse, in defiance of the voice of nature, which tells man in everything given to his view or his feelings to stay at home himself and keep all under shelter that he can. Here are we, setting forward to spend 5 dull hours in another man's house, with nothing to say or to hear that was not said and heard yesterday, and may not be said and heard again tomorrow. Going in dismal weather to return probably in worse. 4 horses and 4 servants taken out for nothing but to convey 5 idle, shivering creatures into colder rooms and worse company than they might have had at home." Emma did not find herself equal to give the pleased assent, which no doubt he was in the habit of receiving, to emulate the "very true, my love," which must have been usually administered by his travelling companion. But she had resolution enough to refrain from making any answer at all. She could not be complying. She dreaded being quarrelsome. Her heroism reached only to silence. She allowed him to talk and arranged the glasses and wrapped herself up without opening her lips. They arrived. The carriage turned, the step was let down, and Mr. Elton, spruce, black and smiling, was with them instantly. "What an excellent device," said he. "The use of a sheepskin for carriages. How very comfortable they make it. Impossible to feel cold with such precautions. The contrivances of modern days indeed have rendered a gentleman's carriage perfectly complete. One is so fenced and guarded from the weather that not a breath of air can find its way unpermitted. Weather becomes absolutely of no consequence. It is a very cold afternoon, but in this carriage we know nothing of the matter. Snows a little, I see." "Yes," said John Knightley, "and I think we shall have a good deal of it." "Christmas weather," observed Mr. Elton. "Quite seasonable. And extremely fortunate, we may think ourselves, that it did not begin yesterday and prevent this day's party, which it might very possibly have done, for Mr. Woodhouse would hardly have ventured had there been much snow on the ground. But now it is of no consequence. This is quite the season indeed for friendly meetings. At Christmas, everybody invites their friends about them, and people think little of even the worst weather. I was snowed up at a friend's house once for a week. Nothing could be pleasanter. I went for only one night and could not get away till that very day se'nnight." Mr. John Knightley looked as if he did not comprehend the pleasure, but said only coolly, "I cannot wish to be snowed up a week at Randall's." At another time Emma might have been amused, but she was too much astonished now at Mr. Elton's spirits for other feelings. Harriet seemed quite forgotten in the expectation of a pleasant party. "We are sure of excellent fires," continued he, "and everything in the greatest comfort. Charming people, Mr. and Mrs. Weston. Mrs. Weston, indeed, is much beyond praise. And he is exactly what one values. So hospitable and so fond of society. It will be a small party, but where small parties are select, they are perhaps the most agreeable of any. Mr. Weston's dining room does not accommodate more than 10 comfortably. And for my part, I would rather, under such circumstances, fall short by 2 than exceed by 2. I think you will agree with me," turning with a soft air to Emma. "I think I shall certainly have your approbation, though Mr. Knightley, perhaps, from being used to the large parties of London, may not quite enter into our feelings." "I know nothing of the large parties of London, sir. I never dine with anybody." "Indeed," in a tone of wonder and pity. "I had no idea that the law had been so great a slavery. Well, sir, the time must come when you will be paid for all this, when you will have little labour and great enjoyment." "My first enjoyment," replied John Knightley as they passed through the sweep gate, "will be to find myself safe at Hartfield again."
On Christmas by John Bamfield. With footsteps slow, in furry pallly clad, his brows enwreathed with holly never sere, old Christmas comes to close the waned year, and I the shepherd's heart to make right glad, who, when his teeming flocks are homeward had, to blazing hearth repairs and nut-brown beer, and views well pleased the ruddy prattlers dear hug the grey mongrel, meanwhile maid and lad squabble for roasted crabs. Thee, sire, we hail. Whether thine aged limbs thou dost enshroud in vest of snowy white and hoary veil, or wrapp'st thy visage in a sable cloud, thee we proclaim with mirth and cheer, nor fail to greet thee well with many a carol loud.
Jane Welsh Carlyle was the wife of essayist Thomas Carlyle. Their marriage was tempestuous and complicated by other relationships on both sides. This letter is to Jeannie Welsh, dated the 28th of December, 1843. A thousand thanks, my darling, for your long, good Christmas letter, and also for the prospective footstools. Anything like a worthy answer you have small chance of getting from me today or any day this week. I have just had to swallow a bumper of my uncle's Madeira, which is capital drink, to nerve me for writing at all. A huge boxful of dead animals from the Welshman arriving late on Saturday night, together with the visions of Scrooge, had so worked on Carlyle's nervous organisation that he has been seized with a perfect convulsion of hospitality and has actually insisted on improvising two dinner parties with only a day between. Now, the improvisation of dinner parties is all very well for the parties who have to eat them, simply, but for those who have to organise them and help to cook them, c'est autre chose, ma chère. Well, that's another thing, my dear. I do not remember that I have ever sustained a moment of greater embarrassment in life than yesterday when Helen suggested to me that I had better stuff the turkey, as she'd forgotten all about it. I had never known about it, but as I make it a rule never to exhibit ignorance on any subject, devant les domestiques, before the servants, for fear of losing their respect, I proceeded to stuff the turkey with the same air of calm self-dependence with which I told her some time ago, when she applied to me, the whole history of the Scotch Free Church dissensions, which up to this hour I have never been able to take in. Fortune favours the brave. The stuffing proved pleasanter to the taste than any stuffing I ever remember to have eaten. Perhaps it was made with quite new ingredients, I do not know. Yesterday I had hare soup, the turkey, stewed mutton, a bread pudding and mince pies with Mrs. Alan Cunningham, Miss Cunningham and Major Burns, son of the poet, to eat thereof. On Monday, hare soup, roasted Welch, mutton stewed beef, ditto pudding, ditto pies with Robertson and John Carlyle, and the disappointment of Darwin. And all that day, to add to my difficulties, I had a headache, so bad that I should have been in bed if I had not had to stay up to help Helen, whose faculties get rusted by disuse.
Published in 18 monthly instalments, starting in November 1698, The London Spy, by Ned Ward, satirical writer and publican, was described as a complete survey of the London scene, full of racy anecdotes and character sketches. The Merry Christmas Carnival being now come on, we wandered about like a couple of runaway prentices, having confined ourselves to no particular port, uncertainty being our course, and mere accident our pilot. Every street we passed through, smelling as strong of roast beef and rosemary as Pie Corner does of pig and pork in the wicked season of St. Bartholomew. Every alehouse we came at was serenaded with a drum to thunder their rattle-headed customers into a good humour of spending their pence like asses, which they got like horses. Every now and then we came to a common vaulting school where, peeping in, we saw drunkard tarpaulins and their tawdry trulls dancing to a Scotch bagpiper or a blind fiddler, and at least 17 strumpets to one that had modesty enough in her looks to be thought otherwise. Sometimes meeting in the street with a boat's crew just come on shore, in search of those land debaucheries which the sea denies them, looking like such wild, staring, gamesome, uncouth animals that a litter of squab rhinoceroses dressed up in humane apparel could not have made to me a more ungainly appearance. I could not forbear reflecting on the prudence of those persons who send their unlucky children to sea to tame and reform them, which I am well satisfied is like sending a knave into Scotland to learn honesty, a fool into Ireland to learn wit, or a clown into Holland to learn breeding. By the time we had made these observations and reflections, we were straggled into Wapping, and being pretty well tired with our walk, we went into a public house to refresh ourselves with a sneaker of punch, which most likely to prove the best liquor that end of the town could afford us. The first figure that accosted us at our entrance was a female wapineer, whose crimson countenance and double chin, contained within the borders of a white calico hood, made her fiery face look, in my fancy, like a round red-hot iron glowing in a silver chaven dish. My friend, having a sword on, I observed to him she was most respectful, asking him in a voice as hoarse as boatswain, "What'll you please to drink, noble captain?" After we'd answered her question, she had soon prepared us a little bowl of spiritual diapente, which, for want of better, we were forced to dispense with. Up the chimney corner sat a great hulking fellow, smoking a short pipe of stinking tobacco, looking as melancholy upon the fire as a female wretch does upon a Smithfield pile, when she is brought to be burnt for high treason. By and by, in comes my landlady, and, like a true lover of industry, began to read him a lecture against laziness, tormenting the ears of the poor dejected water rat with severe reprehension after the following manner. "Why, how do you think, John, in your conscience, I am able to maintain you in this lazy life you lead? Thou knowest I have no money, God help me, but what I work for. As any woman in the parish, therefore, John, it behoves thee to consider I am not able to let thee lie in this condition."
"Why, what a rope ails you, mother," replied the fellow. "Why would you have the conscience to turn me adrift, now I've spent all my money on board you, before I've got me another voyage? You are as hasty with a body to turn him out as a boatswain in a storm."
"Why, but John," replied the landlady, "dost think to get a voyage by smoking in the chimney corner?"
"No," says John, "but how do you think a man can look out without a penny in his breeches?"
To which replied the old beldam, "Why, I would not have thee think what I speak is out of any ill will to thee, for as far as I'm able, here is sixpence for thee. And prithee, John, go and look out, and don't fling it away idly. For consider these hard times, 'tis a great deal of money."
He takes the sixpence, thanks her, and thus she continues.
"There were several ships going out, bound to the West Indies, that want men, and I know thou art as able a seaman as ever walked between stem and stern of a ship, that any commander will be glad to enter thee."
"As to that, mother," says he, "I can speak a proud word for myself. There is ne'er a part of a seaman, from the splicing of a cable to the cooking of a kettle, but what I know as well as the boatswain. Well, mother, wish me good luck. I'll try what I can do, as the gunner said to the cook's daughter."
She wished he might prosper in his endeavours, and away he went. I could not but reflect on the unhappy lives of these saltwater kind of vagabonds, who are never at home but when they're at sea, and always are wondering when they're at home, and never contented but when they're on shore. They're never at ease till they've received their pay, and then never satisfied till they've spent it.
Going Carol Barking, from Cider with Rosie, by Laurie Lee. The week before Christmas, when the snow seemed to lie thickest, was the moment for carol singing. And when I think back to those nights, it is to the crunch of snow and to the lights of the lanterns on it. Carol singing in my village was a special tie for the boys. The girls had little to do with it, like haymaking, blackberrying, stone clearing, and wishing people a happy Easter. It was one of our seasonal perks. By instinct, we knew just when to begin it. A day too soon and we should have been unwelcome. A day too late and we should have received lean looks from people whose bounty was already exhausted. When the true moment came, exactly balanced, we recognised it and were ready. So as soon as the wood had been stacked in the oven to dry for the morning fire, we put on our scarves and went out through the streets, calling loudly between our hands, till the various boys who knew the signal ran out from their houses to join us. One by one they came stumbling over the snow, swinging their lanterns around their heads, shouting and coughing horribly. "Come and carol barking, then." We were the church choir, so no answer was necessary. For a year we had praised the Lord out of key, and as a reward for this service, on top of the outing, we now had the right to visit all the big houses to sing our carols and collect our tribute. 8 of us set out that night. There was Sixpence the Tanner, who had never sung in his life, he just worked his mouth in church. The brothers Horace and Boney, who were always fighting everybody and always getting the worst of it. Clergy Green, the preaching maniac. Walt the Bully, and my two brothers. As we went down the lane, other boys from other villages were already about the hills, bawling King Wenceslas and shouting through keyholes, "Knock on the knocker, ring at the bell, give us a penny for singing so well." They weren't an approved charity as we were, the choir, but competition was in the air. Our first call, as usual, was the house of the squire, and we trooped nervously down his drive. For light, we had candles in marmalade jars suspended on loops of string, and they threw pale gleams on the towering snowdrifts that stood on each side of the drive. A blizzard was blowing, but we were well wrapped up, with army putties on our legs, woolen hats on our heads, and several scarves around our ears. As we approached the big house across its white, silent lawns, we too grew respectfully silent. The lake nearby was stiff and black, the waterfall frozen and still. We arranged ourselves, shuffling around the big front door, then knocked and announced the choir. A maid bore the tidings of our arrival away into the echoing distances of the house. The door was left ajar and we were bidden to begin. We brought no music, the carols were in our heads. "Let's give them Wild Shepherds," said Jack. We began in confusion, plunging into a wreckage of keys, of different words and tempos, but we gathered our strength. He who sang loudest took the rest of us with him, and the carol took shape, if not sweetness. This huge stone house, with its ivied walls, was always a mystery to us. What were those gables, those rooms and attics, those narrow windows veiled by the cedar trees? As we sang Wild Shepherds, we craned our necks, aping into that lamplit hall which we had never entered, staring at the muskets and untenanted, until suddenly, on the stairs, we saw the old squire himself standing and listening with his head on one side. He didn't move until we'd finished, then slowly he tottered towards us, dropped two coins in our box with a trembling hand, scratched his name in the book we carried, gave us each a long look with his moist blind eyes, then turned away in silence. As though released from a spell, we took a few sedate steps, then broke into a run for the gate. We didn't stop till we were out of the grounds. Impatient, at least, to discover the extent of his bounty, we squatted by the cowsheds, held our lanterns over the book, and saw that he'd written 2 shillings. This was quite a good start. No one of any worth in the district would dare to give us less than the squire. Crossing, at last, the frozen mill stream, whose wheel in summer still turned a barren mechanism, we climbed up to Joseph's farm. Sheltered by trees, warm on its bed of snow, it seemed always to be like this. As always, it was late. As always, this was our final call. The snow had a fine crust upon it, and the old trees sparkled like tinsel. We grouped ourselves round the farmhouse porch. The sky cleared, and broad streams of stars ran down over the valley and away to Wales. On Slad's white slopes, seen through the black sticks of its woods, some red lamps still burned in the windows. Everything was quiet. Everywhere there was the faint crackling silence of the winter night. We started singing, and we were all moved by the words and the sudden trueness of our voices. Pure, very clear and breathless, we sang. As Joseph was a-walking, he heard an angel sing, "This night shall be the birth time of Christ the heavenly King. He neither shall be borned in house nor in hall, not in a place of paradise, but in an ox's stall." And 2,000 Christmases became real to us then. The houses, the halls, the places of paradise had all been visited. The stars were bright to guide the kings through the snow, and across the farmyard we could hear the beasts in their stalls. We were given roast apples and hot mince pies. In our nostrils were spices like myrrh, and in our wooden box, as we headed back for the village, there were golden gifts for all.
Dear Mr. Spectator, Mr. Spectator, I am a young woman and have my fortune to make, for which reason I am come constantly to church to hear divine service and make conquests. But one great hindrance in this my design is that our clerk, who was once a gardener, has this Christmas so overdecked the church with greens that he has quite spoiled my prospect, insomuch that I have scarce seen the young baronet I dress at these 3 weeks, though we have both been very constant at our devotions, and do not sit above 3 pews off. The church, as it is now equipped, looks more like a greenhouse than a place of worship. The middle aisle is a very pretty, shady walk, and the pews look like so many arbours on each side of it. The pulpit itself has such clusters of ivy, holly, and rosemary about it that a light fellow in our pew took occasion to say that the congregation heard the word out of a bush, like Moses. Sir Anthony Love's pew, in particular, is so well hedged that all my batteries have no effect. I'm
obliged. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.